panelists on Zeiss, adopted Zeiss, without naming one another. Thank you all for inviting me here. I'm grateful. I'll carry the debate forward. What has been left by Mr. Venkatramani and Professor Devi Chakravarti. In fact, Mr. Venkatramani has set the stage for debating the matter in a very pragmatic manner. And he has said that minority, the concept of minority, has to be addressed in the modern concept and modern scenario, the scenario that's existing at the present time. Because minority is a relative concept. A person who is in minority in a particular place of this nation, it's not necessary that that sect or group is in minority at some other place as well. So minority is a relative concept which changes from place to place, and the concept of minority has to be viewed in terms of the welfare state. This is what the framers of our constitution wanted to achieve. If we see the constitutional safeguards, the grand name of our constitution is the preamble of our constitution, and the preamble of the constitution connotes what the framers of our constitution wanted our nation to be and what we wanted our people to have. We wanted that our people should have justice, liberty, equality for the promotion of fraternity. So all these are interlinked. Justice can be social, economic, political, liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith and worship. Equality of status and opportunity, and to promote a more fraternity, assuring dignity of individual and unity and dignity of the nation. So the purpose of all this is to ensure that people who are deprived in a particular society, their rights should be safeguarded. Because in a particular group there may be some people who, because of their less number, are not in a position to compete with the dominant members of society. They may feel deprived. So we must give them more securities, more protections, so that they come together in the same social fabric and each of them gets the same status, so that we can make it a progressive nation. That is in fact the connotation of the preamble and the objective of the minority status. Now, if we see in rest of India, we have Minority Commission, Minority Act, that's applicable. But Minority Act is not applicable in the state of Jammu and Kashmir and other states as well. So we as members of this fraternity should ensure that we should have debates. A consensus should be built among ourselves. What is the requirement of a particular area, of a particular place, which may include Kashmir, which may include Meghalaya, or some other place where people have different needs? And we can bring a joint consensus in this regard, and then we can put a demand to the government of that area. We can say that this is the requirement of the minority of this place. Because you cannot say that a Muslim is a minority here, Muslim is not a minority here, Hindu is a minority here, Hindu is not a minority here, we are Christians, Sikhs, Buddhists. We have to give way to this concept, and we have to see minority as they exist at a particular place. A Hindu may be a minority in Srinagar, but it's not minority of Srinagar. But in Srinagar, we must give, in Kashmir, in J&K, we must give the benefits of minority to Hindus as well. We cannot deprive them. We cannot deprive Christians, Buddhists of this beneficial piece of legislation which has and rights which has been given by the Constitution. So it must be our endeavor to see that the benefits which have been given by the Constitution are extended to the people in J&K as well. So what do we do? We don't have a law in J&K. We don't have a commission in J&K. We can at least form an opinion, have debates, make a consensus, and try to convince our government and other governments also, so that these things can be formulated, a commission or any other agency can be formulated that will protect the rights of the minorities living in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. In that respect, we have to give away our basic ideological differences. We must come together, irrespective of caste and religion, and come together, have debates, and we are out there to help, did you know? I think I don't have what to say. Thank you.
Now I'll wish Mr. Bajaj Habibullah, former chairman.
Thank you, Supreme Ji. Thank you, Supreme Ji. Professor Kapahi.
This is my yourself. That is the best.
Mr. Venkat Ramani, friend. I would first of all like to start by congratulating you for actually holding this workshop. Around this question of providing the facilities which are available to minorities all over the country, also to the minorities of Jammu and Kashmir. As was mentioned by Shamsi just now and by Sitana, we have in J&K no law regarding the minority rights, but we have a constitution, and to the constitution of India, Articles 29 and 30. It is true that neither of the constitutions actually defines what is a minority. But I think, and this is an argument that was extensively argued by Dr. Chakravarti, but the point is that our Supreme Court has already ruled on this particular subject by T.A. Pai versus the government of Karnataka in the 2002 ruling, and again in 2005, in which it's held that we can constitute a nation of minorities. Now that's a wider issue as to how we are a nation of minority, I won't go into that. But the point is that what these judgments held was, and the TFI judgment held, the minority may be different from state to state. It has been held by the law. And it's for the state to decide what is a minority in that state. So there are states, for example Punjab, has a majority Sikh population. Yet, the Sikhs are a minority nationwide. They have a law of their own, and there's also a national law. So Sikh community gets the benefit of the national law. Similarly, a similar thing could work very easily in J&K. But J&K is also quite distinct in another respect. What you perceive as happening in J&K is a massive national tragedy. I appeal to all of you to please recognize. This is a land which is characterized not by the Western concept of secularism, as really very appropriately put it in Mr. Venkat Ramani. They were not even characterized by simply tolerance. They were characterized by religious harmony. How then do you explain, if there's any other explanation, how then do you explain that? That one of the premier Sufi saints of Kashmir, whose mazar is in Chirar Sharif, is known by his name as Nuruddin, Sheikh Nuruddin, to the Muslims, Nandrishi, to the Hindus, and revered by all. But leave that aside. You may say that, well, it doesn't matter what name you call who by. After all, Allah is also referred to as Vishwanath in Veeravar. The fact is, who was his mentor? His mentor was a Sadhvi, referred to as Lal Gyan by the Hindus and Lal Arifat by the Muslims. And today also you have an argument between people, was she actually a Muslim, was she actually? How does it matter? She was a religious pathfinder, a woman, mind you. And this is the 14th century. A woman, a Shaivite, who therefore carried the Shaivite tradition into the form that Islam took in the land. The premier Muslim religious shrine in Kashmir is the shrine at Hazratgarh, which preserves what's called the Moy Muqaddas. The Moy Muqaddas is a relic of the Prophet. Is there anywhere else in the world where a relic of the Prophet is worshipped like it is in Kashmir? Why is that? You all know what the stoop is, the Buddhist stoop. A Buddhist stoop preserves a relic of the Buddha. Therefore, this tradition comes down from there. Now, these are the traditions. The kingdom of Kashmir came under Sikh, under Maharaja Ranjit Singh, as you know, and which is extended into then what is Ladakh, which was eastern Tibet, western Tibet. But you all realize, and this is not only by Sikhs, everyone recognizes, that Maharaja Ranjit Singh was the greatest ruler of 19th century India. And Maharaja Ranjit Singh's empire was a majority Muslim empire. It covered the present state of Jammu and Kashmir. It covered the northwest frontier. It covered West Punjab. In East Punjab, the British did not allow it to expand. It covered West Punjab, including Amritsar. The majority of that population is Muslim. And in Lahore, you will see, next to the very magnificent Padshahi Masjid built during Mughal times, a precious, like a little jewel box, Gurdwara, to Guru Arjun Dev, who had been martyred centuries earlier at that spot by the Emperor Jahangir. And the question is, you mentioned some, the Bankim Chandra referring to atrocities by Muslim rulers. Rulers always perpetrate atrocities. It's not their religion which is important. But look at the relationship between the public, which I have cited. At the public level, the state of Jammu and Kashmir should have been the recognition of the ethnic religious harmony, which in fact characterized at one time the whole of India. That is why I mentioned to you that we must see what is happening in Kashmir as a national tragedy. There is no doubt that there has been a rise in radicalization of Muslims. Young Muslims, the youth, increasingly radicalized. This was, of course, it served the purpose of our neighbor to try and use public disaffection against their government to further radicalize them into a hatred for the country, for India as a country. A country to which you must note, they had actually, they say that Maharaja signed the instrument of accession, he did. But the movement towards accession to India was led by their own leader, Sheikh Abdullah. One can discuss that later, that is not of relevance today in this discussion. But the point is that here is where we are now talking in terms of protection of the rights of the minorities. This has already been discussed. And the note which has been circulated also discusses this issue. There are several minorities in JNK, but they vary from region to region. In Jammu, 60% of the population, Jammu division, 60% of the population is Hindu, 40% Muslim. In Kashmir, 98% of the population is Muslim, 2% Hindu and Sikh. In Ladakh, it is about 50-50. 14,000 Muslims, 1,13,000 Buddhists. So obviously, the manner in which the Minorities Commission Act is applied in UP or say Andhra Pradesh will not be the same as application in J&K. That is why it is important that the government of J&K should come up with a law of its own. And as chairman of the Minorities Commission, this is what I have recommended. First, extend the national law to J&K and have a law also of your own. By extending the national law to J&K, the population, it's a situation that will become similar to the Sikhs. The population of Kashmir, to whom the local law will not apply because they're not a minority in Kashmir, but they will get the protection of the law everywhere else in the country. And as you know, and Shamsi Sahib will know this, a major threat and a major complaint of Kashmiri Muslim youth is that when they go outside the state to study in other parts of the country, they're often treated with suspicion and often mistreated. I know this recent case where some people were asked to vacate their quarters in Punjab where they got admission into some university. They then get the protection of the Minorities Act at the national level. But inside the state, we all know of the tragedy of the Kashmiri Pandits. A population of 70,000 families, 73,000 families, it was, I think, to start with, now reduced to a few hundred. A population of about 3 lakhs, reduced to less than 3,000. But because that is the most dramatic expression of this tragedy, it is talked about frequently. What about the Sikhs? What about the Christians? They lit a church, a pretty little church, very attractive little church, in Sonawar in Kashmir. Hardly anybody dares go there, even though that area is the maximum security area. And this is what needs to be protected. And therefore I feel that this forum is well positioned to do this. It's a body of lawyers, thinkers, intellectuals. And I appeal to you therefore, at the end of these discussions, and through my very worthy and honourable successor, Mr. Rizvi, make an appeal to the government of J&K to please go ahead with implementing the legislation, even strengthening it. Article 370 allows them to have a stronger law than we have at the national level. The law at the national level is often criticised as not as being wishy-washy. They can have a stronger law, because they have a constitution of their own. Because there is where this law is needed more than anywhere else in the country. Yes, the rest of the country is also facing many problems. We have the Karvapsi, the Gaurakshaks. Government has condemned it, but we feel that not enough has been done to actually curtail this activity. And there's some things that you may think of considering under the Minorities Commission. But it is not that there is a social breakdown in consequence. What Kashmir and other countries is a social breakdown. People recognize it and start taking steps to remedy it. We can very easily say that, oh, it's Pakistan's fault, they've done this and they've done that, and these young people, why, what do they mean by coming and throwing stones? Good, we should criticize. But what are we doing to remedy the situation? It's all very well to blame somebody else, and there's no doubt, and I mentioned to you myself, that Pakistan has played a major role in the subversion of the state and subversion of its social harmony also. But have we done anything to really try and strengthen that social harmony? So I would request you to please consider, during your discussions, ways and means of strengthening, restoring that social harmony. That social harmony is not yet dead. And I wrote an article recently after the attack on the Amarnath Yatris and the condemnation, outright condemnation by Kashmiris, whatever their political persuasion, of that action. And so that here at least is a ray of hope. But it's only a ray. And unless we, as Indians, let us not think in terms of government should do this and government should do that. What are we doing as Indians? It is part of our country. These are our young people who are behaving like this. These are our children, these are my children and your children who are behaving like this. When our children behave like this at home, and often parents of my age will tell you that children often behave in a manner that is uncomfortable for their parents, you throw them out of your house, you put them in jail, you shoot them, you kill them. You make them understand. And it is my belief, if you make them understand, they will understand, because the roots of their civilization, the roots of their culture are strong enough. But let us make that effort. Thank you.
As you have heard from Mr. Bajaj Mubula Sahab, he has given us the gist and he has elaborated about the rights of and need to protect the minorities in Valley, especially in Valley, Jammu and Kashmir, especially in Valley. Now I will request Mr. Razvi Saab, Honorable Sayyid Hussain Razvi, Chairman, National Minority Commission, will come and share his views.
साहब माइनॉरिटीज और खासकर कश्मीर के बारे में जिस कंट्री में जिस देश में माइनॉरिटी के अधिकार कितने सुरक्षित हैं ये डेमोक्रेसी की खूबसूरती होती है। मैं हिंदी में बोल रहा हूँ, आप लोग को समझ में आया देखिए। आज भी माइनॉरिटीज को फाइट करना पड़ रहा है माइनॉरिटीज के बीच में, ये वाकई बहुत अहम मसला है। माइनॉरिटीज कहीं पर वो माइनॉरिटीज हैं, कहीं पर वो मेजॉरिटीज हैं। जैसे पंजाब में सिख मेजॉरिटी में है लेकिन वो देश में माइनॉरिटी है। इसी तरह जैन, जिनको अभी 2014 में माइनॉरिटी का स्टेटस मिला, अगर हम उनके बारे में सोचें तो पॉलिटिकली भी और फाइनेंशियली भी पूरी तरह से मेजॉरिटी में है और मजबूत है। हम कश्मीर अगर जाते हैं तो कश्मीर में देखते हैं कि वहां के कश्मीरी पंडित जो माइनॉरिटी में है। मैंने इस बारे में मेरा अपना मानना है एज ए माइनॉरिटी कमीशन चेयरमैन कि कश्मीरी पंडितों को भी माइनॉरिटी का स्टेटस मिलना चाहिए और इस बारे में कोशिश की जानी चाहिए। मुझे भी 2 महीने हुए हैं ये जिम्मेदारी निभाते हुए। मैंने आने के बाद ही कहा था कि माइनॉरिटी कमीशन कोशिश करेगा कि जो कश्मीर के पंडित हैं, कश्मीरी पंडित हैं, उनको माइनॉरिटी का स्टेटस दिया जाना चाहिए। यह सही है कि माइनॉरिटी कमीशन बहुत सी जगह काम नहीं कर पा रहा है। आज भी हिंदुस्तान के आधे स्टेटों में माइनॉरिटी कमीशन नहीं है। 16 स्टेट ऐसे हैं जिसमें केवल माइनॉरिटी कमीशन काम कर रहा है। माइनॉरिटीज के लिए जो फिक्र होनी चाहिए, जो चिंता होनी चाहिए, उसमें कहीं कमी नजर आती है। बल्कि ये कोशिश ज्यादा होती है कि माइनॉरिटी और मजॉरिटी के बीच में कितनी बड़ी लाइन खींची जाए जो कि कंट्री के लिए भी नुकसानदेह है और सोसाइटी के लिए भी नुकसानदेह है। जैसे ले में बुद्धिस्ट एक तरह से मेजॉरिटी में है, उनके भी अपने हुकूक हैं। पारसी की बात मैं करना चाहता हूं। पारसी आप इकोनॉमिकली देखेंगे तो बहुत मजबूत है, लेकिन अगर उनकी हम संख्या देखेंगे तो बहुत कम है। और उनके यहां एक कोशिश हो रही है, अवेयरनेस पैदा की जा रही है कि जनसंख्या उनकी बढ़े, लेकिन यह सही है कि पूरे कंट्री में अभी भी एक साथ जितने हुकूक मिलने चाहिए माइनॉरिटी को, बराबर के हुकूक मिलने चाहिए। कहने का मतलब यह है कि जो कहीं माइनॉरिटीज है, किसी माइनॉरिटी को ज्यादा हुकूक मिल रहे हैं, किसी को कम मिल रहे हैं। बराबर के हुकूक मिलने चाहिए, इस पर कोशिश की जानी चाहिए। कश्मीर में कमीशन काम नहीं कर सकता, वहां की प्रॉब्लम्स कश्मीरियों की बाहर, जब वो कश्मीरी बाहर निकलते हैं, जैसे अभी हमारे बजाज साहब कह रहे थे, ये बात सही है कि बाहर निकलने में उनको बड़ी परेशानियां होती हैं। उससे किसी ने कहा कि आप ये कह रहे हैं कि कश्मीरी पंडितों को माइनॉरिटी स्टेटस मिलना चाहिए, तो कश्मीर में तो ये प्रॉब्लम है कि उनको कैसे उससे फायदा मिलेगा। मैंने उनसे कहा कि कश्मीरी ब्राह्मण जो कश्मीर से बाहर रह रहे हैं, माइग्रेट करके बाहर आ गए हैं हिंदुस्तान, उनको तो उसका लाभ मिल सकता है, उनको तो दिया जा सकता है। मेरा इतना ही कहना है, अभी एक बार फिर आप लोगों की बात सुनने के बाद अपनी बात रखूंगा। जैसे हमारे चेयरमैन साहब ने बताया है, लेकिन यह सही है कि इस पर विस्तार से चर्चा की जरूरत है। आज तमाम तरह के मसाइल पैदा हो रहे हैं, मसले पैदा हो रहे हैं, और माइनॉरिटी को, मुझे लगता है कि जिस तरह माइनॉरिटी को अधिकार दिए गए थे, जो मकसद था माइनॉरिटी को एक तरह से साथ मिलाने का, मुख्यधारा मिलाने का, वो मकसद पूरा ना होकर के मजॉरिटी और माइनॉरिटी को बांटने की कोशिश ज्यादा हो रही है, जो कंट्री के लिए भी नुकसानदेह है और पूरे समाज के लिए भी नुकसानदेह है। हमें माइनॉरिटी के हुकूक को जानना चाहिए, माइनॉरिटी के अधिकारों को जानना चाहिए, और अभी भी माइनॉरिटियों के अधिकार पूरी तरीके से नहीं मिल पा रहे हैं। आप लोग अभी अपनी बात रखेंगे माइनॉरिटीज के बारे में, उसके बाद मैं फिर दोबारा बोलूंगा। बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया, धन्यवाद।
रिजवी साहब, वैसे तो रिजवी साहब हमारे साथ रहेंगे अभी, तो ये लास्ट में कह रहे कि मैं अपने विचार बाद में भी रखूंगा,
So I will now request Ms. Professor, the senior advocate R. Venkata Muni to conclude the session within 5 minutes, and after that we'll have a 10 minutes tea break, and we will assemble here again after that. Thank you. We had very rewarding presentations, insightful and persuading us to a new chapter of the study. Now, my concluding statements on what we have gathered in the session, if there can be any foundation for the deliberation like this. Whatever be the definitions, the laws, constitution and human rights framework demand that whatever be the definition, rights of identified set of people, that identities deserve protection. That is a well established understanding of rights of minorities. Identities must be protected in their own, for their own value. But then there is a larger element to it. Citizen equality. Whatever be your identity, because the constitution and the national goals of development say that if you are less fortunate, either because of your identity or otherwise, you have a citizen equality where you are guaranteed equality of opportunity in accessing social, economic and political resources. So if definitions come in the way, change the definitions. If definitions are inadequate, alter the definitions. If definitions do not exist, create definitions. I think that's how it is. Citizen equality is what we are talking about. If J&K has a distorted understanding, we're not talking about merely protection of identities. We are talking about citizen equality. So let's understand it. I'm sure there are many of you will have many more things to say and share with us. I'm glad that each and one of you have been able to take time and be here as participants in a common goal of national concerns. Thank you for your attention.